Hello, my name is Rick Herkus, and I'm the Services Director here at MRC, the company behind the Empower development platform. In case you're not aware, Empower is a no-code development platform that lets anybody build apps in minutes rather than days. And that's what we're going to be doing here today in this video. I'm going to show you how we can take an Excel spreadsheet full of data and transform it into a suite of web-enabled applications that really focus on reporting, visualization of data, and BI and analytics. Now, to accomplish this, I'll be walking you through some of the numerous built-in components to Empower. The fact that these elements and functionality are built in means that you don't have to build them from scratch. No need to reinvent the wheel. Instead, you can just add these really helpful, useful components in directly through the Empower development platform. Now, some of these popular features include two-way database communication to let you both read and write to the database. I'm going to be showing you some bootstrap functionality, multi-tenant security, dashboarding, and web pivot tables, amongst many others. Again, I can't stress this enough, I'll show you how we can implement all of this without using any coding. Now, of course, you don't have to use Excel files with Empower. In fact, most of our customers utilize tables provided by their ERP or tables that have already existing on their database in which Empower applications are built over. However, for this video, we're going with the Excel approach just so that way you can see how quickly you can turn data into very beautiful applications that are accessible on any type of device and that allow you to get better access to your data. And that's really what this video is all about. Now, the goals of this video are multiple depending on who you are. If you are somebody who's first checking out Empower, this will be very helpful for you to see some of the functionality behind our software, how you build applications, and really get a good understanding of some of the basics. Now, if you're already an Empower customer, this video also could be quite useful as it shows you how to implement a variety of more advanced topics as well. So that all being said, please understand this video is not designed to be a training video. Instead, it's really designed to give you a good idea of the functionality available within Empower. Specifically, this video is really geared towards reporting and dashboarding specifics. If you're interested in learning about other things you can create with Empower, feel free to check out the other videos in our series. So before we dig into creating all of the applications, I first want to give you a quick tour of what some of the applications will look like once we're all done. So as you can see here, the first application I want to demo off is our order search. So the idea behind this is a user, I might want to just search through orders. I might want to there's several built-in functions here, such as being able to paginate through records or to be able to have a drop-down list to be able to search for a certain state, or I could certainly reorder columns. So if you think about this from an end-user perspective, this is really kind of the first foray into ad hoc reporting for them, right? The user is in control of what they want to see, which columns they might want to show within the application. Maybe some of these columns they don't really care about, so they might want to pull these out. So as a user, I can really customize exactly the data set that I want, and then I could always do things like export this out to Excel. So there's a lot of built-in functionality, even in a simple application such as an order search. Diving in a little bit deeper, the next application that I want to show you is a web pivot table. So the idea behind a web pivot table, again, it takes the ad hoc reporting one step further. You can see we do have built-in search filters and things like that here, but really what this is all about is letting a user slice and dice their report enough to get exactly what they want to see. In this case, I can see all of our sales amounts by year and quarter, and that's great. But maybe as a user, I might want more flexibility than that. Maybe I actually want to see it not by year, but by product class. So the end user has the ability to configure this at runtime rather than needing a developer or a designer to go out and recreate a new report for them. So it's all rolled into one. We're looking at month-to-date sales. We could just as easily look at month-to-date sales and profit. So there's a lot of functionality in there as well too. Same idea, you can still always output to Excel because we do know that's so important for users. The other thing that's worth noting in here, and we'll do this during our demo, is you can come in and select options from a drop-down list in this case here, and I could pick quarter one, and you'll notice when I do that, my result set changes, but so too do my other record selection. So Empower is smart enough to gray out invalid options. So in this case, we know for quarter one, it could only be months 1, 2, or 3, not 4 through 12. So we'll make one of those here today as well. Another report that I want to show you is a top activity report. So we'll create this. This is what we would call our top 10 report. Again, this goes down the same role. This goes down the same road as ad hoc reporting. So I'm a user here, and I'm really interested in knowing just my upper echelon of who are my top. In this case, I can choose as a user my top 5 years based on profit, and I can look through that and see a nice graph will appear as well. I can see exactly what years did the best in terms of their profit. I could certainly come back though and change that to say, actually, I really want to see my top 10 regions based on sales. So again, this is the same report that was just built one time, but that the user can control to get a different aspect of the business. Okay. Another application that we're going to build is going to be the period analysis. And the period analysis is really a great tool at letting you compare how did we do during this time period versus some other time period. So for instance, I might want to say, show me all of the data for this week and compare it to last week, which is what we would call a prior period. And when I run the report, I can see that Amboy Development for this week moved 100,000 units, but for the week prior, I can see 157,000 units. And you can see that listed out here, and we have a nice graph that's printed right next to it. And again, I will show you how to create that in today's video. But what's really neat is that I can come back and say, well, actually, I want to see how did we do this week compared to this week from last year. And I can run the report and just get a different glimpse of trends and get a better idea of analysis as I try to go through and make good, strong, and sound business decisions. Okay, so we will certainly create that as well. Another report that I want to highlight, it's kind of a conglomerate of reports, is our dashboard. And the idea behind a dashboard is, you know, certainly we can have what we would consider to be a user-defined concept or a predefined concept. So in this case, as I look at this dashboard, I can see that I have a blank slate. As a user, I can come in and say, you know what, I want to see an order search, and I want to see a tracking gauge, and I want to see a sales, right? So as a user, I'm kind of picking and choosing what applications I want, how I want them to appear. I can even come over here and do things like configure dashboard layout and maybe redraw them so they take up more space or less space. Maybe we want to move that here, right? So I can, as a user, have really a ton of control as to how exactly I want this to appear, okay? That's all fine and good, and maybe you have users who really want to have utmost control over what elements are going to appear on the page, and if so, that's fantastic. But maybe you have other users who really just want things predefined for them, and that's fine too. You can always come over here to the Options tab and go to Open a Dashboard, and you can choose pre-built dashboards for you. Right, so here's a dashboard in this case that was predefined for me by a different user or by a different developer. So you have the ability to then, if you'd like, you know, customize that and move things around here as you see fit. So you certainly can do things like that and redraw it. The next example that I want to show, of course, it's worth noting that within a dashboard, it's really important to see that a dashboard is really just a connection of several different individual reports and applications that are strung together on one screen. And that's really important too, if you think about your users, to have one place to go to get all the information that they need. Okay. The final application that we will be building together is a concept of sales versus forecast. So the idea behind this is that we would have sales data that you either have from your ERP or you've uploaded it, and then maybe you have some other forecast data that you want to marry together, so that way you could have a report like this to be able to track for you how are we doing within our sales for a current year versus what we projected them to be, so that way we can see the delta between the two to get a better idea of how are we doing versus how we thought we would be doing, okay? And along the way, we'll be creating several Empower components such as data warehouse modules. We'll be building the menu. We'll be handling upload capabilities, so that way we can upload forecasting data, and we'll be building maintainers so we can actually maintain forecasting records. We'll be creating drop-down lists. So we'll be creating lots of different elements along the way, but before we do all that, I wanted to give you an idea, kind of the finished product of what we'll be going towards as we start our journey with creating, really starting off with uploading a spreadsheet to ultimately have this be our finished product. So to begin, the first thing that I'm going to do is in my Empower development interface, I'm going to switch over to a new dictionary that I created called MRC Report. And in MRC Report, you can see I don't have any retrievals or maintainers or anything like that. We're going to start anew. So the very first thing that I need to do is I need to upload my spreadsheet that I have created. Now, again, as I alluded to in the introduction, in your case, you probably already have sales data that's sitting on your database. But for the sake of this video, I'm going to assume that you don't, and that all you have to speak for is a spreadsheet that has, in this case, about 3,600 records of sales data that we ultimately need to take out of Excel and upload to our database, so that way we can start our journey from being data rich but information poor, all the way so we can be data rich and information rich. So we have this spreadsheet, and what we'll do to get it to upload to Empower, I'm going to go to Manage Data, and I'm going to go to Upload Data. And I can choose that I want from a file, and from here I can say Choose File, and I'm going to pick my Sales Excel spreadsheet. Okay. Now in this case, what Empower has done is it has given me a table name and a table description based on the name of my Excel spreadsheet. I can change this to maybe something a little bit more meaningful, like sales info and a description. I could list this as uploaded sales spreadsheet. And then what Empower is going to do is it's going to guess based on the column name what the field should be called, and so we just take it from the column description, but then we look at the contents of the field to get an idea of, should this be a numeric field, should be an alpha, how big should it be? And we do a pretty good job at that. The one thing that I want to adjust, the ship date, we think it's an alpha field, but truly it's a date field, so I just want to mark that as date. So that all being done, I'm going to click Create Table and Upload File, and it's going to do just that. It's going to make a new table on my database, and then it's going to upload all the contents for me. Okay, so it created it. You can see 3,626 rows were inserted into a file called Sales Info. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go out and build our first application, which is our order search. So again, why are we building this one? Well, the idea is that we want to give our users the ability to search through records quickly and efficiently all through a web browser. So to begin, I'm going to click on Retrievals, and I'm going to say Create New Retrieval. Now, it's important to know that Empower utilizes templates to control the look and the feel of the application. So what you'll notice is throughout the build process, it's going to be quite similar as we build our apps, but notice that it's going to be the template that's going to control ultimately the look and the feel and the behavior. So for now, I'm going to go with a multiple row data list, and we'll call this order listing. From there, I'm going to click Save and Proceed. And then Empower is going to ask me, what table do I want to build my applications over? Well, for now, it's a pretty easy decision for us. We only have one table loaded, though we will certainly add more later on. I'll click Sales Info. So now Empower presents me with a list of fields to include in my application. Now, you'll notice that the field in the field description are the same. Empower doesn't know exactly what the field description should be called. So rather than just choosing all the fields now, what we'll do is actually I'm going to backtrack for just a second and go back to Manage Data and go back to Manage Tables. What I'm going to do quickly is I'm going to go into my field listing and I'm going to edit all of my field descriptions. And now it's important to know in Empower we utilize a data dictionary to control our metadata. So I can change the field descriptions here and not actually impact my back-end table. This is all stored within Empower. Okay, so now that I've done that, I'm going to save those changes. Every application we build in this video are now going to utilize the new field descriptions, which will look a lot nicer for my user. So I can jump back to the last application I was on by clicking on this Jump to Last Application button, and I'll reselect my table, and you'll notice now I have much nicer field descriptions. Rather than clicking each and every one of these, I'm just going to click Select All Fields. Empower is going to select all of those to add to my application. So next, Empower is going to take me to our sequencing screen. And sequencing, you can think of it as subtotals or dimensions. In our case, Empower wants to know how it should sort the result set or the application. So in my case, I'll say it can just sort it by customer number. Okay. Next, I'm taken to additional options. What's nice about this screen is Empower will give me a little preview window of what my application will look like right now if I were to build it. So you can see it puts it right in the order of the fields as they were added. But let's say I want the region to come before the state name. I can click on Field Settings, and this is going to take me to my field listing. I can actually click Reorder Fields and utilize a nice drag and drop functionality to drag and drop the region name ahead of the state name and press Save. And I can actually now come back to additional options and see that the region name is now ahead of the state name. So the preview panel is a really nice feature to give you an idea, kind of a little preview of coming attractions. There are several other additional options that are not required that we'll talk through over the course of the video. But for now, I'm going to take you to the build and customize process by clicking on Build and Customize. This is where Empower does all of the heavy lifting. It takes the template that was selected along with the tables and fields that were grabbed by the developer, and it marries them together into an application that's then automatically compiled and deployed to the server, so that way an end user can now run the application. So it's important to know here, I know sometimes new users get a little hung up on this, right now we're in the development environment. Okay, when I click this gold run button, we now become end users. And the end user has the ability to then run the application. So I often think of it as this is kind of the land of the few, where we click execute application, now will be the land of the many. So you can see in just a handful of minutes, we've created that order search application. Again, it's really nice to be able to come in here and say, show me all of the orders that shipped out the frame. So under selections, under description, I can click frame, and I'm brought back to 65 total records with a frame. Now, if I wanted to, There's a several customizable options we have as a developer, and those are available here under Edit Presentation and Edit Properties. We'll talk about Edit Properties first. This lets you control the behavior of the application. So for instance, if I wanted to enable the user to allow them to export to Excel, I could simply click yes on that. If I wanted to let the user reorder columns, I could do that by just clicking enable. I can press save and rerun the application. I don't have to recompile it or anything like that. And you'll notice now I have the option to export to Excel. Or I could now click and drag these columns over if I wanted to as an end user. The final thing that I want to show you within this application before we head off to the painter is our applications are all responsive. So that means they're mobile friendly. So if I were to drag this application over here to make it kind of smaller, and I click on detail view, notice that it kind of resembles what a mobile device would look like. As I scroll down, more records appear, right? You can see it continues to scroll. I can then click on the order and it nicely displays on my screen, and you can tell it's really designed to fit the device rather than really just showing me the PC version. Okay, the final thing I want to show you on this particular application is over here in the selections bar. I don't love having to type in things. I much prefer having drop-down lists sometimes. So maybe in customer name we can change this from being a free form typing to a drop-down list. So to do that, we'll go to Edit Presentation. This takes me to our MPainter. And MPainter lets us edit HTML without needing to go into the code. In our case, this is my output page. I want to go to File and Open File and go to my Selections dialog. So in this customer name right now, you can see it's an input box. I'm going to convert this to, in my case, a drop-down list makes the most sense. So I'm going to click drop-down list. And I'll simply press OK. I'll save the application. Again, I don't need to recompile it. I can just execute it. And now see that in the selections, I have a nice drop-down list. So if I want to see everything from Lumber City Travel, I can do that and press Apply Changes. Okay, and then all of my records for Lumber City Travel. So it's very easy to customize your applications. Now, I realize that things like security are paramount for almost every organization. So I want to show you how simple it is to be able to add security to your application. So I figured let's just do that straight away here on the first application that we built. So understand that security is kind of several layers. The first layer within security is being able to control who is allowed to see, who's allowed access to the application. So very much a pass-fail. Right now, this application is open to anybody. But what we're going to do is we're going to add sign-on security so that way only users with a valid username and password can enter. So to control that, I'm going to go off to admin menu and go to application menu and security, and I'm going to add some users to my application. Now again, you probably already have a list of users within your organization that you want to control, so you probably wouldn't need this step, but we do allow you to specify specific users. Now, the other thing that I want to point out here is I add users, I'm going to specify their password in here as well. MPower is sophisticated enough to validate against several sources, including LDAP. We can secure against users within the database. We can secure like this against username and password in a table, Active Directory. We have a lot of different configuration options. In my case here, I'm going to set up a user called James, and I'm going to press Add User, and then we'll create another user. And this user we'll name Cindy. So I've set up two users in MPower, and I can click Enable Dictionary Security. That will then tell the dictionary to only allow applications to be accessible when a valid username and password is entered. You can see now the padlock is locked, indicating that now only valid users can sign in. So now I go to run my application, you see I'm brought to a sign-in screen. So if I enter bad credentials, Empower will come back and tell me invalid username and password. If I log in with correct credentials, you see I'm brought back to my application just as I always have been. Now, that's great. So that's kind of the first tier. So now, before anybody could run the application, now only Cindy or James can. What we're going to do is take this one step further and implement something called multi-tenant security, or what we call it row-level security. And the idea is that, let's say Cindy is a salesman who should only be able to access folks from Florida, where James is a salesman who should only be able to access customers from Georgia. Now, we could create two separate reports for them, but that doesn't scale very well. Instead, I'd like to create a single application and add a security module so that way Cindy can only see her records, James can only see his records. Okay. Now, to do this, I already have a table built that will tell me that certain users are allowed to see, in our case, certain states. So what we'll do is we'll head back to manage tables, and I want to register that table to Empower. So even though it's on the database, Empower doesn't know about it. So we'll do that by typing in here the schema name, and in my case, the table name. Okay, so it tells me it's been added to my dictionary, and now you can see I have two tables listed. I can even click on this little magnifying glass here to see that there's Cindy and James, and they are allowed to see, in Cindy's case, Florida, and in James' case, Georgia. Okay, great. So now that we have the table registered, what we're going to do is we're going to head back to retrievals. I'm going to add a new retrieval, and I'm going to call this my security template. We'll call this actually our security application. And in our case, we're going to pick the row level security template. So again, now I'm not picking the multi-row template, I'm picking the row level security template. I'll select the user security template, and I'll select all three fields. And again, here in my case, I'll pick the dimension of username. So as I alluded to earlier, it's really not meant to be a training video. We have training videos and documentation on how to implement user row-level security, but I wanted to integrate it into today's video because I think it's really important to illustrate how you could set this up and really what problems and really what type of solution here this can help you with, it because it's so much more scalable. So if I go to execute my application, you can see there Cindy equal to Florida, James equal to Georgia. Okay, so that's perfect. Now I want to go back to my original retrieval, the one we started with, and I want to go into the filtering or record selection screen. And I want to say that I want to filter or implement security on the state name is going to be equal to, but instead of equal to, I can actually pick a pull down and pick the row level security relationship and pick my application that I just built. So what this is saying is at runtime, go figure out who the user is and only show records for whatever that file is controlling. So Cindy's case, Florida, James's case, Georgia. Now, if somebody else were to happen to log in, they would actually not see any records at all. If we had added a third person in and they went to go run this application, they wouldn't see any because the security module only is authorized to show Cindy Florida records and James to Georgia. What's nice about this approach is that it's table driven. So if you add a new employee, you don't have to change the application. You just have to add a new record to the file. So I'm going to re-execute my application. And you can see that now I only have 670 records listed, and they're all from Florida because I'm logged on here as Cindy. Now, if I were to sign off and sign back in, and log on as James, now you see I have 381 records. So it's the same application, but I'm getting a completely different result set. All right, so we've built our order list. Let's turn our attention over to creating a sales analysis drill down report. So this is where we're going to use our pivot table. And the goal behind this application is I want to have an app that lets the end user be able to control it runtime, really turn the knobs to control what dimensions and how they're viewing their application. So really this is quintessentially ad hoc reporting at its finest. So we're going to name this a really exciting name here, maybe our interactive sales analysis pivot table. And I'll pick my pivot table template and we'll go to save and proceed. Now, in my case, I'll go ahead and pick the sales info table once again. And it now I'm not going to pick all of the fields because I certainly don't need them all, but I know which ones I definitely want to have. I know I want to be able to see my data by certain views. I might want to see it by region or by state or by product class or product number. Maybe I want to see it by customer as well. And then maybe I also want to be able to control it by things like year and quarter and month. Naturally, it might make sense to also pick sales and cost. So some fields I actually want to base my numeric results set on, as far as my field measures, and aggregate those values out. So next, we're going to go off into the sequencing section and set those dimensions. So I know that for each dimension, my user is going to be able to drag and drop these elements onto the page. So I want to let them drag and drop by region name. And I also want them to drag and drop by state. And really, the vast majority of these here, I want to implement for them, because the more options that I give to my user, the more functionality the application happens to have. So I'm going to go ahead and pick the vast majority of these fields. We'll have ship month here as well. Now, the next thing that we're going to do is go into calculations, because right now I have sales and I have cost, but I don't have profit anywhere. So I'm going to make a calculation, and a calculation is essentially a new column that only belongs to the application. It's not written to the database anywhere. So here in the profit, I'll maybe set this at 11.0. That means just it has 11 length and no precision, no decimal values. And here we can just do something really simple and say sales minus cost. And I can press save on that. The other thing I want to do is I want to go into record selections. And this time I don't want to add in that multi-tenant security, though we certainly could. But instead I want to show you some other things here as well. Maybe I want to say, I want to let the user pick the ship year at runtime. So I might say equal to runtime value. Or I might want to come over here and say, quarter is equal to runtime value. And this just means don't make me pick as a developer. Let my end user pick at runtime. Again, that gets back to ad hoc reporting. Let the user ultimately control the things that they want to see. So we've got year, quarter, and month. Maybe we want to do something like let them pick the customer. And maybe there's a product class. Maybe we want to let them pick a product class as well. So we have a whole host of record selections for them to pick from. Again, the preview panel will load out and give me an idea here of what my app will look like at runtime. But for the moment, I'm going to go ahead and press build and compile, and we'll wait for this application to build. All right, so that went ahead and built. We can execute the application. You'll notice it's not asking me to sign in. It's able to remember my session from the last time I signed in my application. So you'll notice a few things here in my app. All of those things I picked as sequence keys or dimensions are listed here as these blue buttons. So right now I'm looking at here, let's pull state name out of here and pull ship year on here instead. So you can see that our sales, which is the only checked aggregate value, is showing me it by region and year. But the user can control all of this if they wanted to, right? If they wanted to say, actually show me, keep years up here, but pull months in down here, we can do that. Now, over here on the left-hand side, I can certainly, you know, type in quarter two and press enter, and it'll redraw my results set, and I can only see 4, 5, and 6. But it would be nice to give the user a couple of options here to guide them through and not just make them enter free text. So to control that, we're going to go back into the interface and click on the Edit Presentation to open up our MPainter. And over here on the left-hand side, what we're going to do is I want to show you a couple different options. So we can we're going to right-click, and just like before, we could say Convert to Drop-Down List, but you've certainly seen enough drop-down lists, so maybe instead I can show you a button list. So a button list, as you could imagine, will show me my years here as buttons. So I'm just telling it to be about 50 pixels wide and show 4 per row. I can press OK, save it, and re-execute it, and you can see now I have nice buttons. Okay. We can do the same thing for quarter and month if we wanted to. So maybe for quarter, I sure like those buttons. We can do that one again. But maybe for months, we want to go back to just having a traditional drop-down list. You could do that. Maybe for customer name, instead of a regular drop-down list, maybe we want to have a combo box list. We could do that. And maybe for product class, we might want to use radio buttons. So we could throw some radio buttons on there as well. So we'll press OK, and we can save this. So really, the idea behind this is, as you're in MPainter, we give you a lot of options to be able to customize your report. So if I refresh this report now you can see how much nicer this looks on the left-hand side. I have some nice buttons that I can pick from. Notice that if I pick quarter one, automatically it's going to knock out all these previous months for me. And you can see my customers are in a nice checkmark list, and you can see my product classes are on here as well. So from a presentation standpoint, it looks much nicer as far as these filters go. And I can move the filters off to the side to have some more room here if I need to. So all in all, I would say that the changes we made in Painter for this report, significant improvement from where we were when we first compiled the application. Okay, good. So I'm pretty pleased with how our pivot table is. Next, I want to turn our attention to another report, which will, again, in this vein of creating ad hoc reports, let users be able to see that top tier of how great are we doing in certain areas, or how poorly are we doing in certain areas, by letting them see the top or bottom 5, 10, or 15 rows of data. So for that, we're going to come back to Build and Customize, and in our reports, we'll create a new report, and this time we'll call this my Top 10 Record Report. Okay, and for this guy, we're going to choose our ranking report template, and then, as the name implies, allows us to rank our data. So within Save and Proceed, I'll click on that, and I'll pick the uploaded sales spreadsheet table once again. And in our case, maybe we'll pick, we'll pick the month-to-date sales and cost, and we'll again pick year and quarter and month, maybe customer name and region. So we'll press done there, and in sequencing, again, this is where I can set up these dimensions. I can say, what do I want to let the user pick? My top 10 what? So in this case, anything I pick here will be top 10 eligible. So maybe my top 10 years, or my top 10 quarters, top 10 month, or customer name, top 10 region. I'm kind of going through this quickly because you've already seen me add sequencing on several different applications. Next, in field settings, again, this is all covered in other documentation, but all of these fields that are set to be sequence keys, I am actually going to set to no for display. This tells MPower to not display them. The template is smart enough to know that whatever dimension the user picks, we will show that to them, and the rest will simply be hidden. All right. From now, I can go back to, I can create another calculation for profit if I wanted to. I could do that just like before. And once again, say sales minus cost. So it's fairly easy to add these things in the development interface for the user. So you can see this gives me a little snapshot here of what the application is going to look like at runtime. We'll go ahead and click Build and Customize. All right, so that finished. I can press Execute my application. And you can see now that the template, again, the build process was just the same as before, but the template lets me now have different functionality. So this is now I can say my top 10, and notice these were all the things I picked in my sequencing or dimension area. I can say show me the top 10 regions based on sales. And I can run that report. It'll list them out for me in order. We also show the other fields here as well. I could click on those and sort by those instead if I wanted to, or I can come back and say, well, actually, I actually want to see the top or the bottom 5 months based on cost. And I can run that report and see those listed here as well. Okay. So again, this report lets me see as a user a different aspect of that data. Think about how hard that would have been to pull that data out of our original Excel file. Empower helps me do that within this particular ranking report. So far we've created 3 applications, and they're very separate from each other, right? I've got all these 3 different applications. So how do I send these off to my user? I could send it off to them in a link, in an email, but those tend to get lost. So instead, we can set up a user-based menuing system all built right in Empower. And I can do that by going to Build and Customize and Admin Menu and my Application Menu and Security. So notice, if you remember, we already set up 2 users for Cindy and James, okay? And so this is where we set up our users, and this is where we can control that users can belong to roles. So a user might belong to several roles. Maybe they have a role for their department, or whether they're an internal or external employee. There's lots of different ways to slice and dice roles. Maybe there's a management role and a non-management role. Roles are so important because when we add menu options or links to our menu, they're controlled by role. So only certain roles can see certain applications. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a new role. You can see we have one kind of a global role. That's no fun. Let's create another role, specific one. So let's say there's an accounting role, accounting department. And I can hit add role and return to menu. So here we are, we have this accounting role, and so far we have no users in this role. Let's go ahead and add Cindy, and we'll add James. So now Cindy and James are both part of the accounting role. So just like users can belong to roles, now we're going to go set up applications. But applications can belong to groups. So before we even set up any apps, we're going to come over here to groups, and I'm going to set up this first group of 5 reports. So for these, I'm going to call this reporting. So this will ultimately make a tab. Let's go ahead and spell that correctly. This is going to create a tab in my menu where all of the applications that are part of this reporting tab will belong to. Now, since I'm here, let's go ahead and create one more group, and we'll call this maintain data. We don't have any maintain data apps yet, but we will shortly, and we'll call this a major group here as well. We also have minor groups. As you could imagine, a minor group is a child of a major group. So, you know, for this video, we're only going to make 6 applications. But if you have 20 or 30 apps, you're going to want to organize them into different groups and subgroups. So that being said, we have some users. Those users belong to roles. We have some menu groups. Now let's add the 3 reports that we've built so far into the menu. So you can see although we've built apps, we have not declared any of them menu worthy. So we'll click Create Menu Option. Notice these buttons here match these buttons down here. So for our first application, maybe we want to add that first app, that Order Search. So you can see here's that order listing app. I can click on it. We automatically know the description to put in. We automatically know the URL. Here we can specify what group we want to go in, so under what tab. So we want it to go in the reporting tab. And what role do we want it to go to? Should it go to all users? Should it go to accounting? Well, right now they're the same, but if I add a new user and they're from the IT department, do I want that person to access it? In my case, I don't. I only want the accountants to see it. There's lots of other options on here that we'll talk about throughout the video. For now, the one I want to highlight to you is this Font Awesome icon search. So rather than just have a text-based only link, we can add a little image to it. There's lots of images to pick from here. I'll just go ahead and search for one, and I'll pick this magnifying glass. So I'll click Add this menu, add this option to my menu, and we'll go ahead and add another one. Under Reports, we'll go ahead and pick the first report we made, the Interactive Sales Pivot Table. And I love this name. It's just a little too long as far as titles go, so I'm actually going to lop this off and call it just Interactive Sales. Okay. And again, I'll put it in the reporting group for the accountants. And then for this, maybe here I want to have maybe something with an arrow to indicate that there's a drill down component. So maybe it will say arrow down or something like that. You can always come back and change these things. And then the final app that we just built was our ranking report, which is our little top 10 records report. So again, we want that to belong to reporting. Into accounting. If this feels like I'm being very repetitive, that's good. You're catching on that adding options to the menu is really easy and straightforward. For our image here, that one happened to have a pie graph, so we'll go ahead and pick the pie chart template. So I'll press Add Menu, and then I can now see my menu by clicking on the lightning bolt and click Run Dictionary App Menu. And there we have it, right? So you can see the reporting tab and interactive sales order listing and top 10 record report. Now you'll also notice in our dictionary we have a menu bar. Right now it's blank. If I sign out and I sign back in, you'll now see that these same options are available here. Seems redundant on a menu, but imagine if you're inside of an application like your order listing. And now you don't always have to jump back to the menu. You can get right to where you want to go within any other application. And the reason that was blank is when you sign on, we check to see what options should be in the menu. Well, when we first signed on, there was no menu. That's why we had to sign off and come back in. We do that to, we essentially cache the menu at sign-in to make your applications as fast as possible. Order listing, I would love it if that application were first in the list, so I want to show you how we can do that. This order listing, while it's first in this list, and the menu, ultimately, it's just alphabetical. But we can change that by specifying the sequence number. So if I say this order listing should be 1, I can update that. Interactive sales, maybe we want to be number 5. And top 10 report, as the name would imply, we'll just say number 10. So when the sequence number is specified, we will use that instead to order them. So now you can see order listing is first, then interactive sales, then top 10 report. And to what I was alluding to earlier with the header menu, you can still see these are, this order was specified based on when we signed on. If I sign off, sign back in, you can now see the order matches. So far, we've created a nice set of applications. We've created our order listing, our interactive sales, our top 10 report. We added some security. We added some items to the menu. Now, we're going to turn our attention to an application that's a little bit more complicated, not drastically so, but this is what we would I'm calling our period analysis, and it's a fantastic report. It lets users compare, again, where we are today versus where we were yesterday, or where we were at this week compared to last week. A lot of ad hoc functionality for users to get a good idea from a BI standpoint of, again, not just being data rich, but being information rich as well. So to implement this, we're going to go to reports, and we're going to create a new report. And in my case, I'm going to call this my period analysis BI report. And since it's a report, I probably don't need to type report in there. I'll create just a regular report and press save and proceed. I'll take my main table, the uploaded sales spreadsheet. And in my case, I certainly want to have month-to-date sales, and I know that I want this information listed out by customer. That's really important to me. And certainly I'm going to need the date to compare one thing to the next. So that's it. I'm only going to take three fields just to show you how simple this app really can be. So when I go to done, Empower is then going to take me off to my sequencing screen. This is where I can set up my subtotals, my dimensions. I'm going to pick that I want to subtotal this by customer, and I want to subtotal it. So whether there's one row for a customer or 100, I only want to print that one row of all the information summed up. That being said, I can go back to application settings. This is where we pick the template. I can also tell Empower to not show me any detail records, only to show me the subtotal records only. And in record selections, I'm going to say that I want to pick the ship date, and way at the bottom, way past all of the equal to and all that row level security, is period analysis. And this means let the user decide at runtime how they want to be able to slice and dice this data. Okay, we certainly could have built calculations if we wanted to. That would have been no problem. But for the time being, I'm going to keep this just as simple as possible. Notice that in the preview, it loaded this as month-to-date sales first, then customer name, then ship date. I don't want it in that order at all. So the preview helped me find that mistake. So I can go to field settings and go to reorder fields. I want to put customer name first, then month-to-date sales. And in truth, I don't even need to print the ship date. So once again, we'll watch the build process complete. All right, now that has completed, I can execute the application. And I showed you this back in the beginning, but if I were to say in my case here that I know that I want my application to say the ship date is today, and I want to compare that to, you know what, let's actually say this week and compare it to prior period. So in this case, it's just the last week. And I can run my report, and I can see for every customer their current sales versus their prior sales, and then we have a little chart down at the bottom. But again, what's fantastic about this report is, as a user, I'm making these decisions, right? I'm not having to go back to the developer to ask, well, how did we do this week or last week compared to last week last year? I don't have to go ask a developer that. That's already part of the application. So seeing this, I can already tell that either Amboy has a new customer or they just didn't do anything that prior week. And same thing with Meter Realty. Maybe they're no longer a customer, or they just don't have any activity, and maybe that's somebody I need to follow up with. There's lots of options on here. Now you might be saying, well, Rick, I don't subscribe to a standard calendar. I want something that's unique. Can this handle this? And it certainly can. You know, I can say, how did we do on August 1st of this year? And I want to compare that to the prior period. Or maybe I want to compare it to some other date, right? You can say, I want to compare that to, you know, July 1st or June 1st through June 1st. So you can easily compare two specific dates if you wanted to. So I really like this report, but I want to make it even better. And I'm always concerned, how are people looking or consuming this data? And people are on the go. People have their phones out all the time. I see it all the time at different trade shows and at client sites. So what can we do to make this application even friendlier, look even better on a mobile device? So to do that, we're going to head over to Painter. And there's a couple of things that I want to do here. Down at the bottom, what I want to do is I want to go to layout and click toggle grid mode. And this is going to let me control how things are laid out on the page. And specifically, the first thing I want to do, I don't like that this graph is underneath the data set. I want it to be to the right, where it's going to be more prominent. So I'm going to right click inside of my data set box and go to grid row options and go to configure row layout. And you can see that I have all these different layout choices. We utilize the Bootstrap design that lets us control various different options. And what's important to know here is that the page is made out of 12 columns. And you can control how you want those 12 columns broken down. Right now, we have one column that is all, that's a width of 12, essentially the width of the page. If we wanted to, we could have six, break the page down into six equally sized columns. Or maybe you want to break them down into, three equally sized columns. There's so many different ways to slice and dice this. In my case, I want to split this pretty much down the middle at two columns of equal size. So if you can remember back here, the cell that we're splitting was my data set. It had all the, had all my columns in it. I want to move that data set down here to the left and press OK. Now, you'll see it's kind of overlapping here a little bit. That's OK. And what I'm going to do is I want to move this graph up here on the right-hand side. So I'm going to click and drag this over and just replace the contents within. Now, for the sake of this video, I happen to be running this on a little bit smaller resolution, and that's why it's running together. But you'll see at runtime, we should be OK. So now if I want to say, show me yesterday compared to last year yesterday, you can see that I have a nice chart on the right-hand side, and my data is on the left. And that's all fine and good. Let's clean up this graph just a little bit. And to do that, I'm going to double click on the graph. And in my case, I want to have a 2D cluster bar chart. And the reason I want it clustered, I want it clustered by customer. So I want each customer to have their own little block of bars. Within fields, I want to graph the current and the prior. And I want to do that per customer. And I think it'll make sense once you see it here run. And if you need to rewatch the video, that's certainly fine too. Lots of other choices you can control here, things like the legend you can turn on if you're so inclined. I can save this now and execute it. And again, if we pick this week compared to last week, so you can see now that I have a graph that is clustering or grouping my results set based on the customer. So Amboy Development, you can see, has two columns, one for the current, one for previous. And same for Fort Stewart Bakery and on down the line. So that's really nice. But notice that if I were to be on a mobile device, see how everything is just scrunching together, and that's not really good. So what I want to do is I want to utilize another feature that's just baked right into MPower, and that's the ability to make our application completely responsive. So to control that, I'm going to go back to layout in the grid mode, and right where we were at before down here, I am going to right click in here on the left hand side and choose responsive column. Now, the responsive piece, again, think about those 12 columns that make up an entire page. Right now, MPower is set to say that on an extra small screen, a smartphone and portrait view, to always take up half of the screen no matter what. But what I really wanted to tell it is only do that when you're on a larger device, maybe like a tablet mode or something like that. Maybe then only go in half mode. But otherwise, take up the whole screen. So in this case here, this is going to say on a smartphone portrait, take up the whole screen, a smartphone landscape, it just inherits down, take up the whole screen. And then anything bigger, take up half of the screen, take up half the pages, only six of the 12 columns. So I'm going to say the same thing over here on the right-hand side. So that just controlled the left. We'll do the same thing on the right-hand side that we did on the left. And now when I save this and we come back and rerun the application, what you're going to see happen now is that here we are on a normal device and everything fits quite lovely. But as I scroll down, you'll see that now, where did the graph go? It vanished. Well, it didn't really vanish. It's just below here. So if I'm on those smaller devices, we were able to configure this report fairly easily without any code or anything like that to push that graph to be below the result set. And it will happen automatically depending on your device. So I think that's really great. So we've built this report, now let's go add it to the menu. Because we've already added menu elements and all that other stuff, we can actually come right here into this screen and go add app to and click add to menu, and all the stuff preloads for us. In our case here, we can say that reporting tab we want it to be under, and we want it to fault for any accounting users. And if, again, I like the icons. You don't have to include them. It's not mandatory. But in our case, since we're doing some sort of comparison, we could try to compare. Oh, there's nothing good there. Well, what about a balance? That would indicate that we're comparing. And I can press Add App to Menu option. And then right within our app, if I reloaded my menu, you can see there it is down there under Period Analysis BI. So already we're about an hour in, and we've created several different reports that help me examine different parts of my data set, right? So we started with this 3,500 row file, but we've already done so many different things with it, and all really geared towards that ad hoc reporting to make us information rich. So we have a bunch of applications. I also built a handful of applications prior to the starting of this recording that I'll show you, but I want to put these all on a dashboard, because the idea of a dashboard is we have all of these separate applications that we can pull together into one view, which is really great for executives or people who are always are in a hurry, who want to be able to come to one specific place to see what they need as far as information goes. And that's really the whole point of a dashboard, is to give people very quick access to important data instead of having them hunt around to find what they need to find. To implement, we'll click on Dashboards, and I'll click Create New Dashboard. And for here, we can call this our demo dashboard, since I'm making a demo video. Save and continue. And believe it or not, that actually created our dashboard. It's not very exciting until we do some more things for it, but the dashboard is technically created now. So a dashboard is just a container for lots of other reports and applications. So let's go ahead and register some of those to our dashboard. Pretty easy to do. We've already done all the hard work. Now we're just integrating. So under Add New Application, it already knows what dictionary we want. In our case, and it retrievals the default, we'll pick order listing. And MPower says, do you want the full application or just the table? In our case, the table only is just fine, so it doesn't include the header or the footer or anything like that. Let's add another report. This time, let's add our... I built a handful of reports ahead of time. Let's go ahead and add sales by year. That's a graph, so we'll say graph only. I also added this tracking gauge app, so we'll add that as well, graph only, and we'll add most popular products, graph only. So we've added these four applications to our dashboard. Let's go ahead and run the dashboard. Now, like I said earlier, there's kind of two ways to conceptualize the dashboard. It could either be completely user-defined or predefined by you. So if it's user-defined, when they go to run their dashboard, they're left with just a blank slate. And I think for some users, they really like that they can configure, okay, in this box, I want to have my sales by year, but in this box, I want tracking gauge, and in this box down here, I want something else, and so on and so forth. And then maybe here, I want to configure my dashboard layout to only take up two spaces, and then they can save that. Right, I can say add to dashboard list, and I can say, view number one. You can choose to make it public for everybody or just available for you. So you can certainly do that. And then when you come back to the application the next day later on, you can always say open a dashboard. And there you go. It's preloaded just to where you were at before. And that's good and fine. But sometimes I've noticed that some users like to have it just be predefined for them. And that's totally fine too. You can do that as a developer under here, this layout default dashboard. So maybe in our case, we want to configure our dashboard to not be 3x3, but maybe to be 1x3. So I can come over here and say that I want it to be one row by three columns. Okay, and then I can choose which applications I want to be the default. So even though I have four on here, I'm not going to use all four of them. Maybe I want to have most popular products first, and then I want to have my sales by year next, and then followed by our tracking gauge. So now that I'm done, I like that I can press I can click here to save, and now this is going to be our default dashboard when we run the app, when we go to run the dashboard, right, by default. This is all fine and good. What would make this a lot better, though, is if I'm a user, I want to say, great, well, how are we doing for one customer versus another customer versus another customer? And it's really simple to add that in. It's just a matter of a filter, right? So under filter criteria, I can come in here and say that I want, filter by customer. We know that it's going to be in our case, it's me, customer number. So it's a numeric field. It's just a single value. And in our case right now, we'll just make it be a text input. And then I can map it to each of my dashboards. So under most popular products, I could add this maybe to customer number or record selection one, customer number. They'll do the same thing. Same thing for tracking number and order listing. Here we can just go right to customer number. Again, they mapped exactly the same way. And sales by year, customer number. So essentially, we're saying whatever we type in, filter that through to my applications. So I can press accept. I can rerun the dashboard, and notice there's a filter here now. So if I wanted to type in 100001, run the dashboard, I now get different results because I'm only looking at one specific customer. Now, you're not going to make your user type in customer number. That's silly. Instead, I need to have a drop-down list of customer information. Now, because we just uploaded our file from an Excel file, I don't actually have a unique list of customers. So I'm going to go create that real quickly, and you're going to see that just in a minute how quickly we can do that. So under Create New Retrieval, we'll create customer drop-down list. Here, as you can imagine, we'll take the option list template. We'll pick our sales info table. And in my case, I'm just going to take the customer number and name. Now when we specify subtotaling or order by, I'm going to choose customer name because it would seem really weird if the customers weren't in alphabetical order. You're going to see that, oh, look at this, Amboy Development is listed many times. Well, it makes sense that it's listed many times. This table that we're working over has about 3,500 records. Thankfully, the option list template has a way to remove those duplicate entries for us. So completed, we're going to go to Edit Properties, and I need to tell Empower what value I want to submit to the database, the customer number, what value I want to display in the list, the customer name, and that I want to hide duplicate records. So now that that's saved, I can actually go back to my dashboards, edit that dashboard, and under filter criteria, edit it, and change it from a text input to a dropdown, and I can pick that dropdown list we just made. So I'll press accept, and we've now added, you can see here we added that dropdown list to the dashboard. So we'll rerun the dashboard. You can see it's loaded with our pre-default layout. But now, as a user, I can come in here and say, actually, show me Amboy Development. And you'll notice that we redraw all of those graphs. You can certainly see on the bar and the line chart how the data is changing for each customer that's being selected. So we are certainly using those filters within each of those individual reports. Now, it's important to note that while we happen to be using this predefined dashboard layout, doesn't mean that a user can't come into here and build on what we've already done. So if they wanted to, they could move elements around, they could expand it, they can replace with different applications. Notice that we pulled an order listing, we haven't used it yet, but your user could. And that's the idea behind a dashboard. You're going to want to create a bunch of different reports to let edge users come in and pick whichever ones that they want. The dashboard's built. Let's not forget and throw this on the menu. To do that, just like before, we can go to admin menu and menu and security and register another option to the menu. You'll notice I don't have a dashboard button here, but I can just simply paste the URL from the dashboard where I ran. And here we can say dashboard. And here we might call this sales dashboard. We'll give that to the reporting tab for any accounting users. And then here maybe there's a chart that would be indicative. maybe an area chart or something like that that would clue users into that. So if we go back and run our dictionary menu, you can see now we have a nice list of 5 menu choices. So speaking of the menu, I think this is a fine menu, but I feel like there is a ton of white space on this menu. So what we can actually do instead, we have a couple different varieties of menu choices, and one of which is a card-based menu. So the card-based menu will let us use a lot more screen real estate, make the menu look a little bit nicer too. Now, if you have 30 or 40 menu choices, you probably don't want the card menu, but in our case, since we have so few, it really makes good sense to go into this dictionary files and servlet properties, and there's an option down here for what type of menu we want. So right now, we have text link menu options. We're gonna set that to card menu. So we can refresh our menu, and you can see that now it utilizes much more screen space because all of the menu options are listed in cards. Now, all that extra space is going to be lost if we don't utilize it a little bit more nicely, and we can do that by going back to the menuing and security section and actually configuring this a little bit more. So notice an order listing, for instance, just to pick one, though I could pick any of these. It's a little light on the details. Wouldn't it be nice if we could have some more description here? So we could say sort, search, and, or how about sort and search to find orders based on your customers. And that description will actually be used, if you look here, it's only used for the card, to give some more context to your menu choice. Similarly, this button here says run application. We could change it to say something like find orders. It's only it's only used in the card section, but it gives you a way to further customize the application. You can also customize the height of the card and things like that, but it really gives you a little bit better control of you know what's available as far as what's shown to the user. So we set up our 5 reports. Things are looking really good. What I want to turn our attention to now on our final application, and this is kind of putting everything together, this is the application that's going to let us compare forecast numbers to our actual sales numbers that we've added. So again, in a real world, you probably already have all of your orders within your database already from your ERP, but you may not have forecast numbers. I know plenty of our customers find this exact issue. So what they have to do is they have to create a process that allows them to upload their sales forecast or budget numbers yearly, and then be able to build a report to compare those together. So as we just take a quick look at what we're going to do here on the front end, I'm going to take you really quickly to the application that we had built that I showed you earlier at the start of the video, which was our sales versus forecast. So this is the application we're going to create here, and keep in mind in what we're doing within this application, right? These sales numbers came from the file that we just uploaded. That's fantastic. We need to upload some projected amounts, some forecasted amounts, and then we're going to compare them together into this report. Now, one of the challenges that we're going to run into is the data is on different levels. So what I mean by that is the sales amounts are a line level. So every time a sale was made, a new record was added. For our projected amount, you'll see in a second, we only have one row per year and month. So I need to try to reconcile the data so that way that's at the same level. Thankfully, Empower has a data warehouse module that will let me do just that. So before we can even worry about the data warehouse module or anything like that, what we're going to first need to do is upload the forecasting numbers. So you can see here's my forecasting numbers. You can see that per year and per month, I have one record per customer. Okay, I think that should make sense, right? You're not going to have forecasted amount every time you think you're going to make a sale. It's just going to be rolled up to a certain period. So rather than just upload this straight within the interface, I want to show you how we can actually create a table in Empower. And then what we're going to do is build a maintainer over that table to upload data to the table. And we're going to do it like that because in a real world, that's going to give your user access to be able to re-upload data, like I said, every year. So we're going to create a new table, and we're going to call this our forecast table. Forecast sales amounts. In my case, I know I want four fields. I know I want the customer number to be a field, and Empower already knows about the customer number, so I can click that from the list and it preloads it for me. I know I also want things like the year. Ship year. And I know that I want the month field to be part of this table. And again, I'm just picking these fields because Empower already knows their field length and attribute. It makes it much easier. And then we'll say our projected amount. And we'll say that's going to be a numeric field and maybe 12 length, 0 decimals. So I can say create this table. And Empower does just that. It creates an empty table for me. You can, if you don't believe me, you can see that it's empty here by, you can see here, no record in the file. It's completely empty. So what we need to do is we need to change that. We need to upload data to it. So under maintainers, we're going to build our first maintainer. A maintainer, if you didn't know, lets you write data back to the database. So far today, we've just been reading from it. Here, we're going to actually write to it. So we're going to say create new maintainer, and I'll call this upload forecast numbers. We have several different templates here. I'll pick the data upload. And now we have three files to work through here. We'll say forecast sales amount. We'll take all four fields. And in my case here, for a sequencing or dimension, I'll just pick customer number. It's just the first field. You can see not all templates have a preview. We'll go ahead and build this application. So that application has compiled. When I go to run it, you'll see it's very different. It's not showing me any data. Instead, it's giving me a prompt. So again, I'm an end user. I can pick which file, in my case, the forecast file. I know that the first record has column headings. You can see that here. So I don't want to include those. And then I can choose, what do I want to do? Do I want to add new records, clear and add new, and then what should I do with the existing? In my case, the file's empty. I can simply say add. In my case, it found 481 records, and it loaded 480. The 481st record, the one that didn't load, of course, was the column heading, which we told it to not do. Back in Empower, if I go back to my list of tables, my forecast table, you can now see has all that data. So it's really that easy for the end user to be able to upload this data onto the database that I can now work with it. So as I said earlier, this diagram here will show, I now have forecast data that's in one row per year, customer, and month, and then I have sales data that I have lots of rows for a particular customer, year, and month. So I need to try to reconcile this data, try to put it in the same level. I can do that utilizing our data warehouse or our summary feature. So within summaries, I'm going to say to create a new summary. What a summary will do is it will actually, think of it like a big vise. It's going to take a lot of data, it's going to squeeze it down into a much smaller set of data, which will then dump out to a new file for me. So I will call this my summarized sales by year, month, and customer, which is exactly what I'm doing. There's only one template here for the summary. Here I'll pick the sales info option. And here we'll pick customer number, and we'll pick the year and the month, and then sales, because ultimately that's what I would need to do. I would need to summarize my data by customer, by year, by month, to ultimately get out what the sales is. This is a new screen. You haven't seen this one in the video thus far. And this screen lets me, you know, it knows that we're going to be summarizing data, and I'm going to eventually, in my case, I want to summarize the month-to-date sales amounts. And because I'm making a new field, I need to specify to Empower, in my case here, that it's going to be a summarized field. So we can register this new as a new field name. So I'll press done, and then in sequencing, again, this is that subtotal, this is that dimension piece. I want to tell Empower to every time the year, the month, and the customer is the same, to go ahead and make a subtotal record for it. So basically, for 2018, for January, for customer, you know, that Amboy development, if there's 1,000 rows, it's going to compress those, it's going to use the advice, squeeze it down to just a single row. So that way it's going to match what's over on our forecasting side. It's important to know over here, application settings, we're making a new table for you. So we don't know where to put that table, and by default we put it in whatever the name of your dictionary is, which is in our case MRC report, and we're just going to name it SF for summary file, and then your 5-digit application number, which is 10, so we put 10 in there. We'll build this. So that only, so not only did that build the application, it built a table as well. We're going to now run this application to put data into it. So it found that's the same 3,600 records, but it now compressed it down to just 480. So what that tells me is that there was lots of records for a particular year, month, and customer that all got squeezed down into one record. And that aggregate sales amount was just aggregated into a total amount. So just so you can see kind of the output of that, if I were to look at summary file 10, which we just made, I have one record for customer, you know, 100001 for 2015 January, and this was that summed up amount. So we've built this summary, and that's fantastic. But eventually, we're going to have new sales information that gets uploaded into the system. That summary file is just a snapshot, as it were, of when I just built it a second ago. What we need to do is utilize our scheduling logic to rerun that summary, maybe every night or every week. We can do that over in admin menu. It's one of our utilities, and it's over here at messaging and schedule tasks. For now, I will just call this group nightly and save and return. So nightly is a group that I've made that I can now add individual tasks to. Empower has lots of individual tasks that you could do. You could email a report or output a text message or build a PDF. Lots of different things you can do. In our case, we're just going to run a summary, and we're going to call this our refresh sales summarized table. We'll save and proceed. Empower wants to know which report we want, or which dictionary. And in our case, there's only one, MRC report, and our app, summary 10. So that's it. We've added an application to the task, and now we just have to tell it what frequency it should run. And we can do that over on our schedule tasks module. And in my case here, I can say that I want to have a task called nightly that's going to run every morning at 3 in the morning, and it'll refresh that data for me. So we've built out the data warehouse, we've scheduled it. Now we just have to do the part where we just marry the two pieces of data together. Now, one thing you'll notice that throughout what we've been working on in our report, our months have just been numeric, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I don't think that looks particularly great. So what I want to do is register a new table that just gives me better month descriptions. So back here in register table, I can browse for tables, and I can actually look here at my specific schema, MRC report, and I can find various tables in here. Now in my case, I built one ahead of time called Month Master, and I'm going to go ahead and click on that, and you can see that in Month Master, all it is just 12 rows for month 1 and 01, Jan, 02, Feb, so on and so forth. So what I want to do now is in my report, we'll say create new report. This time we're going to do a crosstab report. And the idea behind a crosstab report is that it's going to let me see all of my months across the top and all my customers down the side. And again, this is really, really important so that way I can see how every customer is doing compared to their forecast numbers for every month within a given year. And really the point of this again is that BI component to let me see where we're doing well, where we're not doing well, so that way I can make better business decisions. So we'll call this sales versus forecast. In my case, I'm now going to take summary file 10, which is going to get me customer number, month to date sales sum, ship year, and ship month. And I want to join that out, and I'm going to join it out to my forecast file that we just uploaded. You can see here, Empower automatically knows to join on the customer, the ship year, and the ship month because the fields are all named the same. If they weren't named the same, that's okay too. We could just create a synonym. In our case, we're going to go out and get the projected amount. And then also, just to be fancy, we're going to, like I said, I like that month master file. So we're going to go get that to get the month description, which I like. So in terms of sequencing or subtotaling, because it's a crosstab report, it's going to be a little bit different. In our case, we want to have our months listed first. So in our case here, we'll pick the month description with a subtotal of no, and then we'll pick our customer name with a subtotal of yes. And actually here, I think I prefer to have the customer name first. The crosstab report documentation goes into this much more detail, but in our case, we want to have our customer name listed first because it's going to go down the left-hand side where our months are going to go across the top. That all being said, we'll come back in here into additional options, and we can just clean this up just a little bit. So we have our customer number. I don't need to show it. Our month-to-date sales, we do want to show. The year and the month don't really need to be on the output. The projected amount should, but maybe with a little nicer description. The customer name we want to show, and the month description, maybe just listed here out as month. And again, we can always reorder things to make them, you can drag and drop as much as you choose. In record selections, I promised you we were going to add a record selection for ship year, so the user could pick 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, so on and so forth. All right, so now comes the moment at hand. You can see the preview here. It's going to try to list out months there in the column headings. All right, this application is going to need a little bit of painting, but for now, let's just execute it and see how far off we are. So notice the selected column dimension is a month. It's the only one there is. And you'll see that as we work down the list, we have customers on the left. Now you'll see that we have month-to-date sales and projected amount. And then we have January, February, March, so on and so forth as we go in down the right. It's a really wide table. Some other things that I don't love here, notice that the sales amount is showing pennies, but the projected amount isn't. As far as we're concerned, from an aggregate standpoint, I don't really care about pennies so much in this application. So in field settings, I can see that my month-to-date sales has a decimal listing, where my forecasted amount doesn't. And then similarly, I can control the edit code, which really just lets me choose where commas go. Notice that the month-to-date sales has a comma and the projected amount doesn't. I can just make that change here so that way they're the same, but I also could have changed that back up at the dictionary level if I was going to be needing to make that change a lot of different places. So if you remember, our application was really wide, really, in my opinion, too wide for what we were trying to accomplish. It's hard for a user to make good, practical decisions when they're having to scroll east and west so much. So I'm going to use Painter to really try to shuffle the deck a little bit here. You'll notice that we have our customer name, that's our sequence key, that's our dimension, and then we have month-to-date sales, and projected amount. Also, it would be really helpful if I had the difference between the two. So that's okay, it's really easy, right? I can go back into calculations. We can go with our tried and true difference calc. And here we can say sales minus what we thought we would do. So positive numbers are good, negative numbers are bad. So we can rebuild that application. And still, so right now we've rebuilt the application twice. I would love to say that when you go to build apps, you know, the first time through it's gonna be perfect. But inevitably, Empower, it's so quick to build applications that sometimes you forget and say, oh, I actually wanted to have this or that or the other thing. It's really easy to be able to go back in and make changes. So in Painter, you can see we have our third column here now. So really, I'm just exacerbating the problem by making this so wide. But you can see that essentially, think about it, like these three columns are going to repeat for every month when this is going to be our grand total on the right. For the time being, just to simplify things, I'm going to actually delete these columns by right-clicking and going to Column and Delete Column, just to make life a little easier. And now here, instead of listing these three columns out horizontally, actually I'm going to list them out vertically. So in Empower, I can say that I want to insert some rows. And I can insert columns here as well. So what I can say here is this we know is the sales column, right? Because it's month-to-date sales. And then here, this is projected amount. So here I can say projected. And here I can say difference. So here I can just drag and drop these elements on the screen. I can do the same thing now in the grand total section. Again, I'm not changing any of the values, I'm just rearranging how elements are laid out on the screen. And while I'm working in HTML, you can see I'm not going into any code. Here I'm left justifying these things, and drag this down here, and here. Now I've freed up all of the space over here on the right, so we can delete these columns now. Oops. Sorry about that. Column, delete column. So now we can save and we can execute. Looking at 2018, and notice now that I have for Amboy development sales projected difference. And while my report is fairly long, what's really nice about it is that it all fits width-wise on the screen. So I can really clearly tell exactly where we are over the course of an entire year for each customer. Now, the one thing that would really make this awesome is if I had some sort of visual clue to say, you know, if a value is negative, make it red. And thankfully enough, we can do that pretty easily in Empower. For this difference field, I can right-click inside of the cell, and inside cell, choose color code cell. And here I can say difference, if it's less than zero, I can say that I want the font color to be red. Save the condition. Really that easy to do. Press OK, press save, and execute the application. Notice now I can see the ones that are, it's painfully clear to me now which ones where we failed to do as well as we said we were going to do. So it's really easy to quickly scan through this and see which ones are red versus which ones are in the black. Now, there's just a handful of more things that I just want to show you real quickly. Within our forecast data, we uploaded that all at once. But if you wanted to change that line item wise, you certainly could do that using another maintainer. And in my case here, I can say that I want to maintain forecast data. We can use our most popular data list with WebForm, which lets me just see my records, but then have the ability to copy, edit, update them. In my case here, I'll take the forecast table. I'll select all my fields, and then for now, my dimensions are now specifying uniqueness. So this table is unique by customer number, and by ship year, and by month. So the preview again shows me those keys along with the value. I can build. And what I'm just going to show you is that we can easily change a value in the database and see it automatically refreshed in the report. So for instance here, we said that for Amboy for January of 2018, we were going to sell 109,163. So let's actually copy that value. We'll come back and run our application. And this is again where that row level security would be really important, right? So you could specify and say only allow you to update your own records, or maybe only a manager should be able to update records, things like that. So we'll say 2018 month one, and we know that Amboy is 100,001. If I edit this record, and let's say we change it and it was really 109,163. We've made that change. I can refresh and notice that now 109,163 now shows as zero. So that all being said, we've created a handful of applications. We can really quickly throw them together on the dashboard. For instance, this maintainer we just built, we could say add to menu. Because we're maintaining data here, I always like the idea of the pencil. And in our case, we'll give access to accounting and not all users. And here we'll put this in the maintain data group. So bam, I can add that to the menu. And going back to our previous app, our upload forecast numbers, we can add that to the menu. Again, we can go to the menuing screen, or we can just do it here. I find here it's a little easier to do. Add to menu. And in my case here, since we're uploading an arrow, I like, or uploading the file, I like utilizing an up arrow. And maybe this upload button. Again, we'll put this in maintain data for the accountants. Okay. And then last but not least was that report we just did, our sales versus forecasting. So if we edit that guy and go to its add to menu, this one was a report. And down here, since we're looking at money, we can add in the dollar sign. Okay. So really in under a minute, we just threw three items together up on a menu. And to see that menu in its entirety, notice we have maintained data and we also have reporting. Okay. I think the reporting is probably more important than the maintaining of the data. So I can go back to admin, utilities, admin, menu and security, and manage my menu group. See, we have reporting and maintained data. I can utilize that same order function to maybe make reporting first and put maintain data second. Otherwise, it's alphabetically in control. Here, though, notice the reporting is now first, maintain data is second. And if I sign off, sign back on as James, you can see now up here we have that same menu option available. So it really lets you move around very quickly in and out of the app. So here we are, we're at about an hour and 45 minutes, and we have taken our scenario of being very data rich and information poor with just a single spreadsheet, and we've uploaded that onto the database and created a whole suite of applications that let us have interactive dashboards and pivot tables that we could drill into on an ad hoc basis. We were able to improve on our existing sales data by able to upload forecasting numbers to have comparisons. We've done BI work to compare where we were this year versus last year. We've put together some nice bootstrap responsive designs so our graphs can be on a mobile device under each other instead of next to each other. Just so much great functionality we've been able to implement and empower in under 2 hours with just a single spreadsheet where we started. With that in mind, I hope you were able to find this video informative. If you have questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. And thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have a wonderful day.